Whisper WD. I haven't used it. It's dry.
Okay, I'm ready. I'm getting ready to cut my dado into the bottom of, into the back of this cabinet. But I want to talk a little bit about a router issue that I read about in comments all the time. And people write, they go, "Oh well, I bought the big Makita router and I want to spin really big bits in it, but the opening isn't big enough." And when I first started woodworking, I built a lot of more traditional stuff with, you know, moldings and raised panels and things like that because I had to. I don't like that stuff. I just don't like that look and I don't like to build it. But I built a lot of it, and people are just missing out on what, how to put those big bits in this router. Just because if you want to try to put the bit in here and then pass it through, it sure, it's not going to work. But what you do is you put the bit in when the router is all the way, when the router is all the way depressed like this, let me get it all the way down. To where just the collet is sticking out of the bottom, and that's what these things are designed for. So now you can mount a whopping router bit in here, and then you just take your base off and you add a sacrificial auxiliary base to get your reference of your cutter in line with the router. It's done every day. I was shown how to do this by a really incredible furniture maker. I mean, I saw a router, a 3-horsepower Makita like this that he had, that had bits this big on it, you know, big winged raised panel cutters. But the key thing is that you want to have a router that has this feature that comes down here and locks this down. So you bring this all the way down and it locks it down, so you can't like have a brain fart and inadvertently release this, and then it comes up and it eats into your base and ruins your router. So this is a really essential thing. And my Festool OF2000 has this, but this is the first time, well, I'm getting ready to do this. So I'm going to have to protrude the bit out of the bottom of a base that's smaller than the bit. So I'm getting ready to do this. But this is the first time since I've had this big 2200 that I found a feature that it doesn't have. You know, I can make it work. I don't think I'm going to release the bit. If I did, I mean, if I release the plunge, the worst that could happen is I'd cut into this base, but I'm not going to. I'm going to be very, very careful. But this is done every single day, you know, so, you know, don't think that that's some kind of limiter. So what I've got here is I looked in my router drawer, and well, let me get this out of the way. I mean, I don't have any of those big 3-wing cutters anymore because I haven't cut that stuff in years, and so I got rid of all that stuff. But it you know, trust me, I've done it, I've seen it done, it works. It's, you know, just because the opening is not big enough does not mean you can't spin something, because just the way I showed you, you bring that down, you mount your router bit in there, you add an auxiliary plywood base onto the bottom. So it's common as dirt. I'm pretty sure, if I remember correctly, I'm pretty sure in one of those early Tay Freed books, he showed doing that, you know. So those were a great series of books that he had out in the 80s, those Tay Freed woodworking books. He was a he was a really kind of down to earth, very skilled guy. But you know, he didn't, you know, he didn't need a bunch of fancy stuff. He was just kind of a get on with it guy. So he was a real inspiration to me. You know, not fussy and stuff in his work, but just really just we're gonna make this happen type thing. So what I've got here is I've got my big router, and I want to spin this. This is actually half of a tongue and groove cutter. It's actually in really good shape, even though it cut a lot. I haven't used it in years. But I looked at my three-wing cutter, and oh my goodness, it looks like someone had been, you know, grinding it on a silicone carbide grinding wheel. It's trashed. I mean, it's just rough. So I popped one of the cutters off. I popped this cutter off, and I had to add a couple shims on the mandrel, since the mandrel was a little bit longer, to get this all this relationship right. But I want to use this base so I don't tip off the corner on my cut, and you can see this won't fit. So I'm going to do the exact same thing that I talked about, just on a smaller scale. So I'm going to pop this on. I'm going to depress the router now. You know, the key thing is with me is I don't want to release it and damage my base. Okay, I may need to release it just a little bit so I have access to the lock nut, collet nut, I mean. Yeah, I think I can. I can definitely get that to work now. Okay, so let me tighten this guy down, and then I'll set my depth and start cutting. Okay, that looks real good. Now I know that I've got a little bit of a radius in these corners, and from where the bearing guide couldn't get all the way back in there, so that I will clean out with the chisel. But when I disassemble it, one of the reasons I like to do this kind of stuff when it's assembled is I keep from making a mistake and routing in the wrong spot. And you know, since everything was dry fit, you know, it's going to go back together exactly in the exact same spot again. So it'll be really good. And I was just admiring how good all these. I mean, look at these. These just look like the wood just disappears one into the other, one plane into the other. So I'm really, really happy with the way the joints are coming out.